Morning. Find a little chilly in here. You know, there's always two good things about Corth Community Church. One is we're undergoing a renovation. And the even better news is we don't have to pay for it. Right? But anytime the college goes under these renovations, unfortunately, they sometimes leave a door or a window open in a place that we can't get at, and that's unfortunately what is happening today. So you will need to, you're welcome to keep your coat on or snuggle. If you don't know the person next to you, you should ask. Okay? But just snuggle in there and keep warm, and I'll try to move as fast as I can. Perspective's an interesting thing. You know, you think a certain way about something, and then you travel or go to school or read a book or meet a person, and sometimes those perspectives change. Physicists have a theory called the Fermi theory that they came up with about 100 years ago. And the Fermi theater is just based on this principle. A bunch of physicists were sitting around, they were thinking, and they're going, okay, we now know through telescopes that there's millions and billions of worlds out there. And they say, there being so many stars and planets and galaxies and solar systems and planets, there certainly has to be life out there. I mean, just the odds of it show that there should be life out there. And they all nodded their head, yeah. And then the physicist said, well, where are they? We can't hear anything. And so they sat around, they thought, yeah, because if there's, you know, all these millions and billions of galaxies and all that, which, you know, we can see, and there's all these planets, certainly somebody has to be technologically advanced enough that they could reach out to us. Like, why have we not heard from people on other planets, you know, except for maybe your crazy cousin Bob, who was abducted by aliens, you know. It's not generally publicly recognized that anybody has done anything. So where is everybody? And so in order to live with that theory, because they said, well, that's kind of what we believe, that there should be millions and billions of different, you know, communities and races out there. Why are they all, where are they? Well, here, we'll come up with a second theory. So the Fermi theory came up with this concept that societies technologically advance to a certain place and then they destroy themselves. So the reason we can't hear from any alien races is out there is because just when they're on the cusp of getting technologically advanced to come get a message out or to come talk to people or whatever, they annihilate themselves, evolution does this thing, and they're all gone in that. And that's why we can't hear anything. Now, it's an interesting perspective. It really is. But it sounds a little simplistic to me. Does it to you? You know, is that theory based on fact or perspective? Because if it's based on fact, then it doesn't look good for the human race, does it? You know, eventually we're going to get advanced enough that we're going to end up killing ourselves, right? Isn't that a lovely thing to wake up to on an Easter morning while you're freezing to death in a church seat, right? But if it's not true, then what if we are alone in the universe? You know, what if the cosmic dice got rolled and we're the only ones out here? Then the world, cosmos seems so empty and cold and dead and all those kind of things. Especially if you don't take into consideration the fact that there may be somebody out there who is way more technologically advanced than me, who maybe is watching me and maybe did come here, but we didn't notice. Or not everybody notices. And that's the interesting perspective when you come to people. I run into, it amazes, I love the sciences, and as I'm talking to individuals and taking a perspective, it amazes me how many scientists have become deists. Deists are people that believe that there must be a God behind the world, universe, because as they look at DNA and everything like that, they look at it and they go, there's no way this just happened. It's just too complicated. There is mathematical and scientific reasoning that somebody, some point, put the universe together. And then there's scientists who I call the anything but God scientists, and they'll come up with any theory, and some of them sound, you know, maybe it's possible, some of them sound not. Real kind of rage right now with physicists is alternate dimensions, right? The fact that we're all alone here and we can't hear from anybody, actually there are millions of universes and millions of Earths, and they're all working in different dimensions. We just happen to be in one that's really quiet. And while there's you here, there's actually a million more you in other dimensions and all that kind of stuff. And you go, well, okay, you know, can we prove that? Well, no, but it's, you know, makes sense, you know. That's why it's so quiet. We can't hear from anybody here, right? See anything but God theory. Today, I want to talk about perspective. I want to talk about the perspective of two individuals, and their perspectives were pretty grim. In fact, their perspectives were all but hopeless. And the perspective of these two individuals, though they are nestled in the same perch as far as their vertical living space for the closure of their lives, their perspectives are completely opposite. And today I want to talk about your and my perspectives. Sometimes you'll get two people and they'll look at the same situation, and one will use it or be motivated by it and will do incredible things with it. Another will be utterly defeated by it, utterly crushed by it, and will be ruined by it. I will never in my life figure out. I've met people who have lived through horrendous circumstances, and they're the most kind, merciful, forgiving, good people you'd ever want to meet. They're salt of the earth. And then another person goes through exactly the same situation, and they're like, you know, I could believe this person's a serial murderer. You know, like they're just bitter and angry, and, you know, just their outlook on the world is so negative. And this, you know, the logic in me says they both went through the same circumstances. Why are they different? And so people will look at it and they'll go, well, this person, you know, maybe they had a Sunday school teacher, or maybe this person had a parent that rescued them or went to live with a grandma or something. Somebody stepped in. But you look at the person that had the bad stuff happen to them, and they had good people touch them in their lives too. There is no reasoning beyond it except their perspective. One of them looked at their adversity and said, this will make me bitter. And one looked at the adversity and said, this will make me better. And that leaves us with an interesting choice today, because although some people may dispute this, I happen to think that the God of the universe who loves us gives us all a choice. Every single one of us is given a choice. And the choice is a choice of perspective. It is whether I will acknowledge a good, loving God and through my adversity allow him to make me better, or I will look at this universe in a perspective that there is no God, and I will blame instead other things, and I will choose a perspective that is based on looking out for me. Those are the choices that are given every human being. So let's walk through this and we'll talk about the takeout. The red letter day. We're talking about different sentences. Jesus, when he was crucified, when you were crucified, you asphyxiated yourself really over days. That was a major cause of death in crucifixion. And so it was a horrible, horrible thing. The Romans picked it up, I believe, from the Carthaginians. The Carthaginians, who were a Phoenician tribe that kind of replanted themselves in North Africa, and were barbaric people in some ways, the way we would look at them. They sacrificed their children to the flames, and they, you know, experienced all kinds of cannibalism and all these kind of things. But the Romans picked up some habits from the Carthaginians, you know, during the Punic Wars, and one of the habits they picked up was the idea of crucifixion. Crucifixion was so cruel that in the Roman Empire, a Roman citizen could not be crucified. It was against the law to crucify another Roman citizen. But the Romans, when they conquered lands, were quite willing, in cases where they really wanted to make a statement, to crucify people who were not Roman citizens. And basically the idea is that you would nail someone to a cross, and then that person has to, in order to breathe, push themselves up on the nails or the ropes, grab a breath, and then fall down again. It was exhausting. You couldn't go to sleep. Often it would last for days. It was a horrible, horrible way to die. And this is the way Jesus was dying. And most people, when they press themselves up on the nails or the ropes, would say things. They would beg for mercy. They would maybe disperse some business. They might repent of what they're doing. They might curse the Romans. They might, you know, all kinds of things people would do. Jesus instead, when he pushed himself up on those nails, would say some incredible things. Things that you could take the different comments he makes, and each one you could write books about. Can you imagine being able to say something so brief and have it so rich with meaning? That would be an admirable goal in any of us, that when we speak, our words have rich meaning. And so during this series, we've looked at a couple of them. On Sunday, we talked about Father, forgive them, they don't know what they're doing. And we talked about the collective sin the human race is presented with, and how evil is so much a part of who we are and what we are, how the only way we would get saved was through a good God, a perfect God, laying down his life. And when he did that, the all-encompassing price he paid was so enormous that there is nothing we can go to God with that can't be covered by it. And so that's what we talked about Friday. Today we want to talk about a couple of people who were crucified with Jesus. The Romans didn't normally crucify people in singles. In fact, in the fall of Jerusalem in AD 70, they crucified people all up and down the road to Jerusalem as an example to the Jews. And thousands of people, but in this case, they were executing three people. And so two different criminals came up with Jesus. And one of the scriptures says that while they were pressing themselves up on their nails, they mocked him. And they said things like, you know, because Pilate, the Roman proconsul, had taken a sign. Normally, they had a little sign that would go up when you're crucified to say all the bad things you've done, why you were being crucified, as an example to other people. We don't do public executions anymore. I kind of think that sometimes it'd be good to bring them back, but especially when I'm driving. But they used to list these things. Well, Pilate had a very unusual statement he put on Jesus's sign. He said, here's Jesus, the King of the Jews. And he put it in three languages so that everybody could read it. Anybody who was literate would read it. And I think he did for a couple of reasons. One, he was very angry at the Jewish authorities who pressured him into crucifying Jesus, even though he didn't want to. The second thing is, one of the things that they accused him of was that Jesus said he was the King of the Jews, and so they used that to kind of twist Pilate's arm, and so Pilate put it on the sign to kind of make them angry, because the Bible tells us they went to Pilate and said, no, put down, he claimed to be the King of the Jews. And Pilate, you can just see the irony here, says, no, what I've written is going to stay. You guys put me in this boat now, you're going to wear it. And so Jesus had the King of the Jews. And these thieves had heard about Jesus, and they heard about the miracles and the healings and the great teaching and all those kind of things. And here he is ending up in the same place they were. That was their perspective. Here they were, elevated above the crowds, looking down, gasping for breath, facing their impending death. And here was this teacher, this good man, this incredible storyteller and miracle worker who walked on water and fed the crowds and did all these things. And he was in the same boat they were. Can you imagine what you're thinking, wow, life's ironic. Here I am, I'm up here because I deserve to be here. And this guy's up here, and he doesn't deserve to be here, yet we end up in the same thing. Life is ironic. You know, why do good things or bad things happen to good people? Well, here's a perfect case in point right between us. This is probably the nicest guy that's been in Israel a long time, and he's getting the same punishment we are. That's pretty ironic. And they kind of mocked him about it. They said things like, well, if you're the Christ, help us, you know, get us out of this mess. When you're in a desperate situation and there is no hope, you will grasp at straws. And the one straw they grasped at in a mocking way was, maybe we can, you know, bully him into using this miracle power and we might get out of this, you know. Thick as thieves, I guess is the best way to put it. And Jesus didn't respond to them. Until one of them, his perspective began to change as he watched that Nazarene carpenter die the slow, agonizing, torturous death. And he was listening to what he said. And he was hearing, Father, forgive them. They don't know what they're doing. He was hearing these words. And his perspective began to change. And he recognized that he only had two options. One was to die bitter, and the other was to reach out in faith in the hope that his scenario could become better. And he started to see this man between them differently. His perspective began to change. And in his dark criminal soul, a light came on. And it grew. And as he was struggling with breath, he acted. The other thief continued to mock Jesus, continued to rant, continued to burst out in anger. Historians tell about the death of Joseph Stalin, probably the most cruel human being that ever lived. He dwarfed Hitler in the horrible things he did to people. And his daughter recounts on his deathbed, that Stalin could not talk. He'd undergone a stroke. But right before he died, he shook his fist at the heavens. You got to admire his determination, right? Here's a guy about to go, and he's still, you can't get me to God, right? Very determined individual. Very stupid, but very determined. So this man continues to mock Jesus. He's shaking his fist at God as he dies. And the other thief pushes himself up. And I can't imagine he said this all at once. He probably came out in spurts. But he rebuked the other thief. He said, stop it. We are crucified because we deserve it. We should be on these crosses. But him, he does not deserve to be here. And he shuts up the other thief. And then he sags down, pushes himself up, and talks to this dying man beside him and said, when you come into your kingdom, remember me. Last straw. Last hope. Last opportunity to be better. Now, think about the irony of this, really. You know, like, if Jesus was who he claimed to be, he's been a criminal his whole life. Why would God take him in? He was so bad that the worst of the worst have placed him on a cross to die a long, torturous death, the most horrible death possible. I don't know what he did, but whatever he did, it must have been really bad. Yet, he looks at this person between them and says, hey, don't want to bother you, but if you enter in your paradise, like, you know, this is going to happen, maybe say one for me, preacher. I used to do prison ministry when I was in Bible college, and that was one thing you heard a lot, you know. You'd go and you'd preach to the inmates, and it was interesting. They would bring the sex offenders in one point because they segregated them from the rest of prison, and then they would bring in the kind of the murderers and the, you know, violent criminals and, you know, all those in another perspective and you know, you would share the message. And I was pretty green then. I was, you know, 20 years old or something like that. But often heard guys as they're walking by, they'd say one for me, preacher. You know, and it was kind of like, yeah, right. You know, like, you're just mocking me. But I was clever enough in those days that I said to myself, you know, just watch, I'm going to. Say one for me, preacher. Jesus pushes himself up in the nails and says, today you will be with me in paradise. Okay, let's think of the ramifications of this, okay? Because from our perspective, in our penal system, this guy's been so bad, you know, we're locking him up or we're doing away with him so we never have to deal with him again. Whatever he's done is so horrible that he just needs to go. Humanity has wiped their feet and brushed off their hands and is just doing away with this guy. And here he is talking to the Son of God, and he has no opportunity to do anything, right? He's not going to come down from that cross and take care of widows and orphans. He's not going to raise money for, you know, AIDS awareness. He's not going to, you know, run a food bank. He's not going to be a productive member of society. That gigs up. Whatever he could have done in his life to do the right thing was basically over. He had squandered his life. And sometimes we look at that and think, well, God, that's too easy, man. Like, all the guy did was ask and put a little faith in you, and that was enough? What gives with this? And what, how does it apply to me? Quentin, I'm so sorry. I haven't followed my notes at all today. I'm just talking, so please forgive me. He's trying to figure out the PowerPoint, and I'm doing the best message backwards and upside down, so thank you for his patience. Our techies are just such wonderful people. Well, again, what gives with that? You're saying, Scott, maybe we can work out a deal here then, okay? How about I do whatever I want for the rest of my life, you know, if it feel good, you know, do it. Just party, 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 and then that last moment when I feel the heart attack coming, I'll go, hey, say one for me, preacher. And I'll be scot-free, so to speak. That doesn't seem fair. Or what about Mother Teresa? I mean, she did so many good things. She did them over and over and over again, and she rescued so many people, and she did so many wonderful things, and she was such a good person. What about Gandhi? What about all these beautiful, wonderful people? Shouldn't they be the ones to go to heaven? And guys like this guy, who wants them? The trash of society. Those who had the choice and from the get-go did the wrong, violent, horrible, abusive thing from day one. And this is where we come down to a theological principle, which is really important to grasp here, okay? Jesus did not come to make bad people good so much as he came to make dead people alive. You get that? There is an inherent goodness to come into Jesus. But when he made his declaration, he said, I have come to bring them life and life to the fullest. You see, that man on that cross was dead. He was a dead man walking, or dead man's hanging, probably would be a better way to put it. And here's the truth. If I'm honest, so am I. I live at a point in my life where every day is a gift. You see, I'll let you in on a little something, and I'm not like grasping for sympathy or anything like this, but my father was 48 when he keeled over. His father was 51, and his father was 47. Wheeler men don't live long. And so when I turned 48, I started counting days. All of a sudden, every morning when I get up and I put my feet on the ground, woohoo, I'm around a little longer, you know? And I mean, there's doctors looking at me and all those kind of things, you know, making sure my heart's good and all that kind of stuff. I'm not an idiot. I mean, take care of myself, but for the most part, except ice cream. That's my kryptonite. But this might be my last day. This might be my last sermon. This might be my last walk. This might be my last chance to say something to my kids. I live in that reality every day because it is a conscious reality that men in my family don't live long. They can go anytime. And so with that in mind, and I just hope I didn't prophesy and like this afternoon I'm going to be gone. You got to do me a gift though, okay? This is a deal. My wife will not cooperate in this and you need to make her. Cremate me, put me in a soup can, dump me in the autonomy, and tell her to take the money, go to Aruba, find a young man named Paco who's a massage therapist, and have the time of her life. Because I'm not going to care. Paco. Come see me, Paco. But in that reality, I'm not scared. I'm not. It's not that, you know, someone said, I'm not scared of dying. It's the process that really bothers me. And I understand that. And I that scares me. But I'm not scared because there was a time when I made that realization that I wasn't going to live forever. And on my own, I was hurting a lot of people. And on my own, I was really self-absorbed. And on my own, I was really aimless. And on my own, I was reacting to every feeling. And on my own, I couldn't figure stuff out. And so I reached out to that man in the middle, that cross. And I said, you know, I've heard it said that you can take my past and my disappointments and my regrets and my guilt and shame, and you can take that death out of me, and you can make me alive. And if you can do that, I'm willing to get on your boat. Now, I have to say, I was 11 at the time. It's not that I committed a lot of horrific sins. I mean, stealing my sister's Smarties was probably the worst of it. But I stole the turtle once, too. And I picked on my little sister a lot. Here's a list. I can give it to you, but it probably just bore you. But never mind. You don't want the dirt. But I'll say, when I said that prayer, all of a sudden, it was like a zillion pounds off my shoulders. And I remember jumping up and down and going, I'm clean, I'm clean, I'm clean. I was by myself in my living room. And I reached out to him, and his words to me, they weren't what he said to the thief in the cross, but it meant the same thing. He said, today, you're with me, and I'm with you. And I have never been alone since then. Philosophers will tell us there's always four things that people spend certain portions of their life trying to pursue. Origin, morality, meaning, and destiny. Okay? Outside of the concept of God, the explanations for all those things are a major bummer. Origin, you're here by accident. Some cesspool of chemicals put together, out crawled a lizard or a fish or a snake or something. And, you know, it all developed and all those kind of things. And, whoa, hey, we're here, freezing to death at church. Yeah, that's great. That origin does not motivate me to be anything but self-absorbed. I'm sorry, maybe you look at it differently, but there's nothing noble about that. I'm here by chance. Whoa, exciting. Morality. Well, if that's the case, why be good? It's more fun to be bad. At least I thought it was until I learned that actually being good is actually quite a giddy experience. But some Christians would diverse on that. You know, some Christians, you look at them and they look like they've been sucking green persimmons for 6 years. You know, they're just, you know, all tight and legalistic and grumpy and all that kind of stuff. Listen, if you meet a grumpy Christian, it's not Jesus that's the problem. Because loving him with my whole heart and giving my life to him has given me a joy that makes me a walking party. And I get into trouble a lot for that, but you know, the truth of the matter is it brings me joy. Morality. Why be good if there is no God? You say, well, I don't want to go to prison. Yeah, but I mean, you can still do lots of bad stuff and not go to prison. In fact, I'm sure the government's going to legalize just about everything in the next few years, so have at it, you know? Meaning. Well, why am I here? Everybody asked this question at one point. What is my purpose in being on this dirt rock for the 50, 60, 70 years? What is my meaning? What is my purpose? Is it just to, like, exist? Is it any wonder that the highest suicide rate right now is among 20-somethings who have heard this philosophy over and over and over again and have looked at it and said, my soul is empty, and are taking their lives? Down in Nova Scotia, one of the universities, have had to erect meshes around all the tall bridges they have near the area because so many people were jumping off and committing suicide. First time ever in England 4 years ago, they did a statistic and they asked this question, are you lonely? The whole history of that question being asked on surveys, it was always seniors that said that, seniors who had lost their friends or their spouse or all those kind of things. First time ever, the people who answered the highest to that question, are you lonely, were 20-somethings. They were lonely. They had social media themselves into isolation to such an extent they had nothing. No meaning and no reason. Why am I just here to make money? Is it just about pleasure? Because the more pleasure I get in, the less it means. Just pursuing these things. You know, like somebody said, you know, I'm not a millionaire, but I sure like to try it. I would too. But, you know, truth of the matter is there's a lot of miserable millionaires out there. What is our meaning? And then destiny. Okay, so I'm here for a certain period of time and then that's it? You know, some movie Hollywood stars have got into reincarnation, you know, and they think, okay, well, maybe I come back as, you know, a garter snake or a fruit fly or gorilla or something like that, depending on, you know, what I do and, you know, what charities I support and, you know, what I do for global warming and all those kind of things. But reincarnation is neither biblical nor makes sense. It doesn't. Who wants to have zits again? Who wants to mess themselves in their diapers again? Who wants to do that? That does not sound feasible nor enjoyable. What is my destiny? All four things are answered on the cross. Where am I from? You were created by a good, perfect, loving God into an imperfect, broken, evil world. And you may say, why did he let it get this way? Because love always has a choice. If you are controlling your kids so much that they can't take risks and can't walk away from you, then you are not loving them. You are controlling them. God is love. And with love comes choice. It is not love unless he gave humanity the opportunity to step away from him. And we chose that. And we have been paying the consequences ever since. We all carry this burden with us. Morality. What is morality? Morality is that when I accept Christ in my heart, that cross gives me a new morality. It covers my old brokenness. And each day as I rise, I acknowledge that cross. And I do my best to live like the man who hung on it. Do I succeed all the time? No. Do I fail a lot? Yeah. Do I have bad days? Yes. But a long obedience in the same direction. Morality is the way he loved me, he's told me to love you. Meaning, we were placed on this planet to love God and to love each other and to love those who haven't heard the good news yet to such an extent that we have more than enough to do. We could spend every moment of every day fulfilling those three things and never reach it completely. That is our purpose. You have a purpose here. And then destiny. Today you will be with me in paradise. Destiny is that when we look to that man in the middle, when our perspective acknowledges him and we say, you did this for me? I love you too. When you enter your kingdom, can I come? You're my only hope, Obi-Wan Kenobi. I'm sorry, it just sounded right to put that in there. You are my only hope. And then when we entrust him, someday, some of us sooner than later, are going to step from this world into another. And we're not going to be reincarnated. There's not going to be a big dark room and everything will phase out. There's not going to be anything. You are made in God's image. You will live forever. At that moment, you can step into the light with him and live forever with him in what the God of the universe called paradise. I have a perspective on paradise. It looks something like Aruba, but imagine God. What his idea of paradise is. I'll tell you, it ain't going to be clouds and harps. It's going to be awesome. Because God is good and loving. And when you love somebody, you prepare the best for them. Jesus said to his followers, he said, I'm going ahead of you to prepare a place for you. hey guys, I'm gonna change the sheets and get everything working. I'm gonna get a beautiful place for you. You're gonna walk into it and go, how did he know? Everything I've ever dreamed and loved and all those kind of things. And that's not a bribe. There's no way you can earn your way to that. It's a gift. It's that one gift you always wanted but never expected to get. Origin, meaning, morality, destiny. They were all answered by that Nazarene hanging on that cross. And that is all I got to say about that. I'm going to pray in a minute. And during that prayer, if you're here today and you've gone, you know, just like Scott, when you were 11, I never really thought about this before. And while I'm sitting here, my perspective has changed a bit. And as much as, you know, I'm here and kind of have lived my life a certain way, I'm kind of feeling something tapping on my heart. Something inside me is saying, I need that. So I'm going to say a prayer, and I'm going to give you an opportunity to pray along with me and to say that prayer similar to that thief. Today, remember me. Today, acknowledge me. Today, I choose you. And I want to go from that certain death into life. Now, I want you to know, this is a big, big commitment. This is the most important commitment you'll ever make. Okay? This is not an easy challenge. But if you're sitting there today and you're hearing this message and you feel God tapping you on the heart, I would only encourage you, don't turn them down. Don't turn them down. Step into his world. Because here's the thing, we're all hanging on that cross. Without him, we are hopeless. And you know it, I do too. We never will be able to be all we're meant to be without God. And so if you acknowledge that truth with me, then say this prayer with me and enter into his paradise. Father, thank you for your grace and love. Thank you that on that horrible day, Good Friday, you died for me. What more could you have done to say I love you to a dying, broken world than I love you? And Father, just as there are two thieves, one on either side of him, I have a choice. I can decide to go it alone and basically live a life which really is a mocking of the God who made me. Or I can reach out and I can say, remember me. And so Father, as I say that prayer, I ask that you would remember me. That you would take me into your family, and that from this day forward, I will live my life in acknowledgement of you, just as your death has wiped me clean. I want to start anew with you each day, no longer dead in my sin, but alive in you. I ask this in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. I'm going to ask the worship team to come up. We have a quote show that's going to come up that basically walks you through a song that was written about the thief on the cross. And following that, we'll have a song. But while we're doing that, just ask the baskets. Come around. There's outies and innies. The outies are the ones you take stuff out of. The innies are the ones you put stuff in. If you're a guest here today, don't feel obligated to give. We want this to be a blessing to you. We want you to receive the gift of Christ that we're talking about today. And I would encourage you that if you've done that today for the first time, come and talk to me about it, or come talk to somebody. We had someone on Friday accept Christ, and they came talk to me, and are just really excited about working with them. And if that's you today, then let me know. I'm not going to single you out. I'm not going to, hey, everybody, look at this creep. I'm going to basically give you a Bible, okay, if you don't have one. And I'll just keep in touch with you and help you along. This is a really important time in your life. Well, that's going around. There'll be the innies come around afterwards. So the ones you put stuff in. So if you fill out anything, give anything like that, just put them in there. And that. God bless you. Just enjoy the quote show.
And I know that my time is coming soon. Well, it's been so long, oh, such a long time since I've lived with peace and rest. And now I guess things work for the best. And I know that my time is coming soon. Well, who is this man? This man beside me, the day he called. I'm slowly fading, but I deserve what I'll receive. Jesus, will you enter in your kingdom? Could you please?
You stand. We're going to sing a new song called Because He Lives. The end of May, we're going to be doing another worship night, and this is one that we've pulled out to do, and it's the perfect song for this morning. And if you know it, sing along, and when you get it, sing along with us as well. It's pretty simple, based off a hymn, so most of you should know it.
Thank you. That was a beautiful song, John. Patrick and Elise, you've won the coffee card. You feel special? Thanks. We're going to take communion now. Communion is basically something Jesus instructed us to do to remember the death that he died for us, the price he paid. And so if you want to take a couple minutes after the service, and we'll just make our way over here and grab the emblems. There's a cracker and a little cup of juice. Apparently there's gluten-free crackers now. I don't know what that's about, but they're there if you like gluten-free. And if you want to do that afterwards, if a couple of you big, burly, strong people would, you see my son Eric, he's the tall one. See the two tall, good-looking, single gentlemen at the back? go to him afterwards, after we have communion, and say, hey, can I help out with anything? Because he's down a couple people today, and he's our room coordinator and stuff like that. So, and he does a great job. He really does. I'm not just biased because he's my son and really good looking. He does a good job. And so you can just go up to him afterwards if you have a few minutes and say, hey, can I help out with anything? And he'll have you stack some chairs or something like that. God bless you as you do that. We'll see you over there in about 5-10 minutes and have communion. If you have to go, God bless you. Come back next week. The story continues.